Thank you for allowing me to be here. As you said, my name is Joe Major. I'm the pastor of Faith Baptist Church in Louisiana from America. And so I want to come and share the gospel of Jesus Christ with you here today and preach to you here this morning. But before we do that, why don't we just open up in a word of prayer and then we'll get right into the Bible. I'm not going to keep you real long this morning. I know you've had a lot of meetings already. But let's go ahead and pray here this morning as we get started. Dear Heavenly Father, I just thank you for allowing us to be here this morning, Lord. I just ask that you be with these police officers and their stations, their divisions, Lord, that you just help them to perform their jobs in accordance with your word, that they would obey the laws of God, Father, and that they would honor you, that they would be honest and true and just, and that if they obey you, that you would bless them in those things, Lord. Lord, I just ask that you help us to learn something from your word here today, and in Jesus Christ's name I pray, amen. All right, so I'm going to start out in Romans chapter number 1 here this morning. And what I want to preach to you here this morning on, of course, is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And then according to the Bible, some of the dangers of rejecting the Lord Jesus Christ. And in Romans chapter number 1, the Bible says this in verse number 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them. For God hath showed it unto them, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by things that are made, even his eternal power in Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that, when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man, and to birds, and to four-footed beasts, and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up unto vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error, which was meat. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. And so the Bible says right there, all throughout this chapter, it's talking about how that people had rejected God, had rejected the Lord Jesus Christ, and that because they had rejected him over and over and over again throughout their lives, that the Bible teaches that God would then give them over to a reprobate mind. Now, the word reprobate, God defines that word for us in the Bible. In fact, in Jeremiah chapter number 6 and verse number 30, the Bible says, reprobate silver shall men call them, because the Lord hath rejected them. And so the word reprobate in the Bible means to be rejected by God. That a person can actually get to the point where they can be given up to these things and rejected by God because they have first rejected him. Now I'm sure as police officers, there have probably been many things that y'all have seen in your lifetime, whether it was a terrible crime, a murder scene, or something that's taken place, and you probably wondered, how can people do these things, right? I mean, are these people even human? How is it that they can do such things that are just so horrible in this world and seemingly not have a conscience about it? Well, the Bible talks about those people, and we just read about them there, that because they had rejected God over and over and over and over again, and because when they knew the truth, that they didn't receive the truth, that the Bible teaches that God would give them over to a reprobate mind. In fact, the Bible goes on to say in Romans chapter number 1, verse 29, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, spiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents without understanding, covenant breakers without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. So these people have gotten to the point where they're so wicked, they've rejected God so much that they actually get to the point where not only do they enjoy it when they do those things, and the Bible gives that whole list there, fornication, murder, deceit, debaters, that whole list there, not only do they have pleasure when they do those things, but they actually take pleasure when others do those things according to the Word of God. And the Bible is saying that these people are reprobate, meaning that they have been rejected by God. But why is it that they were rejected by God? Well, we read the verse earlier, verse number 21 said, because that when they knew God, they glorified Him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their foolish imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened, the Bible says. So the reason why God gave them over was because they had rejected God. Now there are many scriptures in the Word of God that talk about men like this. In fact, we'll take our Bibles and go on to 2 Peter chapter number 2, and I'll read you some other scriptures here this morning that talk about men like this, because there are many men that fall into many different categories. For example, you've got all the false prophets out there, right? And have you ever seen a preacher that, you know, was a false prophet and he's just fleecing the flock of God and he's taking all their money and it seems like he's living the good life. He's driving the nice cars. He's got the fancy clothes. But yet his flock is suffering. Well, why is that? Well, the Bible talks about them in 2 Peter chapter number 2. And the Bible says, but there were false prophets also among the people. It says, even as there shall be teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. And through covetousness shall they with feigned words, that means false words, it says, make merchandise of you. So the Bible says that they would make merchandise of the people. That they're just in it for the money, they're in it for what they can gain, they're in it for just exalting themselves and promoting themselves. You see, this is talking about men that the Bible describes as a reprobate in the Word of God. It goes on to talk about them in verse number 3. And through covetousness shall they with vain words make merchandise of you. Notice what it says. Whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not. You see, every person has a choice in this life, whether to receive Christ or to reject the Lord Jesus Christ. And many people, not everybody becomes a reprobate, but some people do. But the danger is that if you reject Jesus Christ, the Bible teaches that your soul will go to hell. That at the end of this life, you're going to go to one of two places, right? Either to heaven or to hell, according to the Word of God. But the Bible says that these false prophets, their judgment lingereth not. It slumbereth not. Meaning that they are not having to wait for their judgment to come. Meaning that the judgment has already taken place upon them. And that judgment is that God has already given them over to a reprobate mind. He's already rejected them. And their destination is hell. That is where they are going to go. And that's why when you see all these horrible things that take place in the world, and you see these crimes that are seemingly just so evil that you can't comprehend why a person would do that, well, it might be because that is a person who is a reprobate that God has rejected, and they've been given over, and the Bible told us there that they are full of all unrighteousness, that they're full of everything, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, despisers of God, proud, boasters, the Bible says, that they have been given over to all of those things according to the Word of God. And you know, there are men in the Word of God, we don't have time to look at all the places here this morning, but there are men in the Word of God that the Bible talks about that God gave them over, that He rejected them. For example, in the book of 1 Samuel, I believe it's chapter number 2, and then in verse number 12 and on through that chapter, it talks about the sons of Eli, and the Bible says that they were sons of Belial. Now, do y'all understand who Belial is? Who's Belial? Belial in the Bible is the devil. And the Bible says that they were sons of Belial, that they were sons of the devil. And it talks about all the wickedness that they would do. But their father was a priest. Their father was a man of God. They were men that knew the Word of God. They had been trained up in the priesthood. They knew what they ought to do. They knew what was right. But yet the Bible tells us about those two men that they would lay with the women that came to the door, that they would have immoral relations with them, and that they hated the sacrifices of the Lord, and that because they had done those things, the Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter number 2, that God determined that He would slay them. So God determined that He was going to actually kill those men because they had become so wicked, so evil, so vile, that He determined that He was going to take them out of this life. And so you see in the Word of God, there's a danger for those that would reject the Word of God, that they could be given over to a reprobate mind. And back here in 2 Peter chapter number 2, the Bible talks again about these men in verse number 14. And it says this about them, having eyes full of adultery and that cannot cease from sin, beguiling unstable souls. Beguiling unstable souls, the Bible says. You see, they prey on the weak. They go after those that are weak, that can't defend themselves. And how often is it that y'all probably see crimes where usually it's somebody who's preying on somebody that's weaker than them, right? I mean, typically, you're not going to go prey on somebody that's bigger than you, that's stronger than you, because you think that you might lose that match, right? Well, these men, they're going after those that are unstable souls, and they're beguiling them, they're deceiving them, the Bible says. And it goes on to say about them, and hearts they have exercised with covetous practices, meaning that they desire the things that everybody else has. That they covet after what you have. They covet after your money. They covet after what you have and what everyone else has. They exercise their hearts unto covetous practices. And the Bible says that they are cursed children. And verse 15 says, which have forsaken the right way and are gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, who loved the wages of unrighteousness. And so the Bible says there that they had forsaken the right way. Now, in order to forsake the right way, that means that you have to know the right way, doesn't it? It means you knew what was true, you knew what was right, and yet you forsook that. And that's what the Bible shows us about these reprobates. Remember, the Bible said there, and it said back in the book of Romans, that because when they knew God, they worshipped Him not as God. You see, they had forsaken the right way and gone the way of Balaam. Now, Balaam was a man in the Bible that he sold out the children of God for money. He sold out the children of God for promotion, for honor, and for the things of this world. And that's what the Bible is describing there about these men, that they go the way of Balaam. They've forsaken the right things, and therefore they are given up to a reprobate mind. Why? Because they knew the right way. Now, what is the right way in the Word of God? Because many times, you know, we hear many things from the preachers of this world that tell you, well, what is the right way? How do you get saved? How do you know God? How do you go to heaven? And many times you'll hear men in this world tell you that you have to keep the commandments of God, that you have to be a good person, that you have to do the right thing, that you have to go to church, that you have to be baptized, you have to do all this stuff in order to get to heaven. But what does the Bible say about that? Well, the Bible says in Ephesians chapter number 2 and verses 8 and 9, the Bible says right there, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So the Bible right there says that, hey, salvation is the gift of God, and that it's not of works, meaning not of the things that we do, that there's nothing that we have to do to earn our salvation, because the Bible says it is the gift of God. And when he says it's his gift, he's saying that it is free, because a gift is not something you have to work for. It's not something you have to pay for. If you were to pay one penny for a gift, then it's no longer a gift, is it? Then it's something you pay for, it's something you bought, it's something you work for, it's something you earn. But the Bible says that it is the gift of God according to the Word of God. And the Bible makes it plain, because many people would say, well, I believe you have to keep the law, you have to keep the commandments, right? In order to go to heaven, you have to not steal, you have to not kill, you have to, you know, not commit adultery, you have to obey the commandments of God. But the Bible says in Galatians chapter number 2 and verse number 16, it says, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ, and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. And so the Bible says, hey, no one, no flesh can be justified by the works of the law. And the reason being is because every one of us have broken the law, have we not? When it comes to God's law, I mean, the Bible tells us that we've all sinned, that we've all come short of the glory of God. And because we've sinned, the Bible says that if you offend God's law in one point, then you're guilty of the whole, the Bible says. Therefore, you cannot work your way to heaven or earn your way to heaven according to the Bible, which is why the Bible says back in Romans chapter number 3 and verse number 10, it says, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. You may say, well, I'm a righteous person, I'm a good person. Well, according to the Bible says there's none righteous, meaning that there's not a one of us that are good. And why is that? Because it says in verse 23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And so every one of us have sinned. We've all come short, which means that we can't work our way to heaven. But you know, there is something that we do earn for our sin. Do y'all know what that is? What do we earn for our sin? Well, the Bible says in Romans chapter number 6 and verse 23, it says, for the wages of sin is death. You see, the payment for our sin, according to the Word of God, is death. That is what we earn, and that's why Jesus Christ had to come pay that payment. You see, the payment for your sin is not your good works. The payment for your sin is not keeping the law. The payment for your sin is not what you do. The payment for your sin is death, the Bible says. Now, is that just talking about physical death? Well, the Bible talks about the second death in Revelation chapter number 21 and verse number 8. The Bible says this right there, Revelation 21, verse number 8. And the Bible says this, but the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. And so the Bible says right there that all of us deserve to go there. Now, you may not be the idolater or the murderer or the whoremonger or the sorcerer, but the Bible says all liars. Now, let me ask you a question here this morning. If I were going to call you a murderer, how many times would you have to commit murder? Just one time, right? So in order for me to call you a liar, how many times would you have to tell a lie? Just one time. And every one of us have told lies, have we not? I mean, every one of us have told a lie in our lifetime. And because of that, the Bible is saying, hey, we all deserve to go to the lake of fire. And the Bible says that the lake of fire, that is the second death. And that is the payment for our sins. Which is why the Bible teaches that Jesus Christ, when he died, he paid that payment for us. And his soul, the Bible teaches, went to hell for 3 days and 3 nights. And then he arose from the grave. He did that to pay the payment for us. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't want to pay that payment, right? I mean, who in here would want to pay that payment to go to hell and to have to pay for your sins? Is there anybody that wants to do that? I mean, none of us want that for our lives, right? That's why Jesus Christ paid it for us, because we cannot pay that payment. And if we don't receive that payment, then we would have to go to hell for eternity according to the Word of God. Now, Jesus Christ, when he paid that payment, did he pay for some sin or all sin? And many people would say, and most people would say, all sin, right? But then let me ask you this question. Well, what about suicide? Let's say somebody committed suicide. Could they go to heaven? Well, what does the Bible say? Let me ask you this. If you said all sin when I asked you that question, well, would not all sin include suicide? It sure would, right? If we're going to say all sin. And you know, the Bible does say all sin. In 1 John chapter number 1 and verse number 7, the Bible says this. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. And so the Bible does say all sin, that even somebody that commits suicide could still go to heaven. You know, there are men in the Bible that committed suicide that the Bible teaches are in heaven. One of those was King Saul. King Saul, the last thing that he did was he fell on his sword and he killed himself. But yet the Bible says he was among the prophets, and the Bible teaches that all of the prophets are in heaven. So therefore, King Saul is in heaven. And according to the Word of God, the Bible says that, yeah, those who commit suicide could go to heaven. Jesus Christ himself said, all manner of sins shall be forgiven, except for what? Except for blasphemy against the Holy Ghost, right? So according to Jesus Christ, that even suicide could be forgiven if somebody did the right thing. Now, let me ask you this. Jesus was able to pay for our sins because he wasn't like you and I. The Bible teaches that he was tempted at all points like as us, yet without sin. But was Jesus Christ God? And I will put this forth to you. The Bible said earlier, it said, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And the Bible does teach that Jesus Christ was God. Because otherwise, how could he pay for our sins? You see, how could he pay for our sins if he was just a man? According to the Bible, he would have had sin if he was just a man. And according to the Bible in Matthew chapter number 1, just to give you one clear verse in the Bible makes it clear that Jesus Christ was God, because you have God the Father actually speaking and calling him God. And in Matthew chapter number 1, verse 21, it says, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord. So it's God who is speaking this. And it says, by the prophet, saying, behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Now did you catch what it said there? It said that God called him Emmanuel, which meant God with us. Therefore, God called him God. Another place in the scriptures is Hebrews 1:8, where the Bible says, the Father, it says, but unto the Son he saith, thy throne, O God, is forever a scepter of righteousness. And so God the Father, in both those places, called Jesus Christ God. And that's why he could pay for our sins, because he was God manifest in the flesh, and he had no sin himself. Now, according to the Bible, you know, what is it that you have to do in order to be saved? What did Jesus Christ say? How do you get eternal life? Well, Jesus Christ said this in John chapter number 3 and verse number 36. He said, he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. And so the Bible makes it clear. There's one thing there that the Bible says that a person must do in order to have everlasting life. And it says that you simply must believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, it does not say repent of your sins. It does not say that you have to turn away from your sins. It does not say be a good person. It does not say to go to church or be baptized or anything like that. Jesus Christ, who was God manifest in the flesh speaking this, he said, he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. Now, what does that word believe mean? Well, let's say you were going to do a favor for me, and I said, I believe in you. What am I saying? I'm saying that I trust you. I'm saying I don't trust myself, but I'm trusting you to get it done, that I'm trusting that you're going to do the job. And so when the Bible says that we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, it's saying that we put our trust in him, that we recognize there's nothing we can do to save ourselves, and that we are only trusting the Lord Jesus Christ.
Now, to show you that Jesus Christ emphasized this, if we look over at verse number 14 or 15, it says that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And so the Bible says that you must believe in the Son of God, that you must believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, not trust yourself, not trust your works, not trust the things that you do. And by the way, according to Jesus Christ, you can't lose that salvation either. That if Jesus Christ gave you salvation today, if you had salvation today, there is nothing you could do tomorrow to lose it. That means that if you even committed murder or suicide or something like that, then the Bible teaches that you would go to heaven. And there were men in the Bible that did those things, that committed murder, that committed suicide, that committed adultery, and yet the Bible teaches that they're in heaven. For example, David, King David, he committed murder. He committed adultery according to the Word of God, and yet David is still in heaven, the Bible says. Why? Because the Bible says that salvation is by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and it says, not of works, lest any man should boast. You see, if salvation were by works, by what we do, I could brag about myself, right? I could say, I'm going to heaven because I've done this. I could go to heaven because I go to church. I am going to heaven because I'm a good person. But the Bible says that God doesn't want you to boast of yourself, that our boasting is in Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ himself said in John chapter number 10, verse number 28, he said, and I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. And so Jesus Christ there in three ways told us you can't lose your salvation. Because Jesus Christ said, and I give unto them eternal life. Now what does the word eternal mean? The word eternal means forever, right? Well, if you could lose it, was it forever? No, it wouldn't be forever, would it? So Jesus Christ said, you can't lose that salvation. And then he went on to say, and they shall never perish. Now that doesn't sound like you can lose it when he says you're never going to perish. And then he said, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. Now, ask yourself, are you of mankind? You're a human being, so the answer should be yes, right? So can you pluck yourself out of the hand of God? Well, Jesus Christ said, neither can any man pluck themselves out of the hand of God. So you can't pluck yourself out. You can't lose that salvation. And the last verse I'll give you here this morning is Romans chapter number 10 and verse number 9. And the Bible says this, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus. Now notice it does not say confess your sins. It says confess the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, and it says, thou shalt be saved. You see, that's what the Bible says. The Bible says, if you do this, you will be saved. If you confess and you believe in Jesus Christ, the Bible says you will be saved. And if you believe these things that I've said here this morning, then all you need to do is you need to pray to God, not to man, not to me, but to God, and tell him that you believe in him, that you believe what his Son did, and you pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the Bible says that thou shalt be saved. And the Bible says down there in verse number 14, it says, how then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? I'm sorry, verse 13 says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, whosoever means anyone, doesn't it? So you could be a pretty bad person and still call upon the name of the Lord. Now listen, you've all been given the truth here this morning. I don't know you all that well. And so you have to make a choice for yourself with what you've heard this morning, whether you're going to reject it or whether you're going to accept it. And I showed you the danger earlier, that if you reject Christ over and over and over again, a person can get to that point in their life where they do become reprobate. Now, hopefully, you don't get to that point. And some people never do become reprobate. But you know what? If you get to the end of your life and you've rejected Christ your entire life, Well, the Bible teaches that your destination is hell. And hell is forever. It's an eternity. You'll never have the chance to get out of hell. And that's why the Bible says that today is the day of salvation. That you must make a choice about what you are going to believe. And so you ask yourself, do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you believe the things that I've spoken here this morning? And if you do, you simply need to call out to Christ and ask Him to save you. And if you'd like to speak with us about this further afterwards,